what you saw in the Iran-Contra hearings was the exposure of the beginnings of a national security state which believes it has the right to override the Constitution of the United States in the name of security.
I think that there was a substantial shadow government trying to run foreign affairs for the United States.
In any other country, it would have been called a coup. And they seem to have gotten away with it.
These are modern-day pirates, these guys. They have escaped, essentially, the control of national governments, but they're available for use by national governments. Sometimes they move under color of, and defend themselves as advancing U.S. national interests in this. But I think that's very secondary with these guys. They're out to make a buck.
I did do it. I am not, as I said in my statement, at all ashamed of any of the things that I did. I was given a mission, and I tried to carry it out.
The Iran-Contra hearings, convened in May 1987 by a special joint committee of the United States Congress to investigate the sale of U.S. weapons to Iran and the illegal diversion of money to the Contras. Often, the official explanation seemed inadequate and contradictory.
Our government has a firm policy not to capitulate to terrorist demands, that no concessions policy remains in force, in spite of the wildly speculative and false stories about arms for hostages and alleged ransom payments. We did not, repeat, did not trade weapons or anything else for hostages, nor will we.
Despite Reagan's denials, investigations soon revealed that arms had been traded for hostages held in the Mideast.
A few months ago, I told the American people I did not trade arms for hostages. My heart and my best intentions still tell me that's true, but the facts and the evidence tell me it is not.
Only days later, it was further revealed that the arms to Iran had been severely marked up. Some of the profits had been illegally diverted to support the Contras, a guerrilla force organized by the CIA fighting the Nicaraguan government. The Reagan administration had a major scandal on its hands. The use of U.S. government money for supporting the overthrow of the Nicaraguan government was specifically prohibited when Congress enacted the Boland Amendment in 1984. Even though it remained in effect until 1986, millions of dollars in profits from Iranian arms sales were secretly diverted to the Contras during this period through contacts with middlemen such as Moniker Gobanifar. Did these hearings uncover the full story behind the Contragate scandal? Or was it merely an attempt to keep the real truth hidden from public view? Peter Dale Scott, professor at the University of California at Berkeley, has conducted extensive research on covert action and CIA activities. The results are detailed in his book, The Iran-Contra Connection.
I think the real issue was that both the administration and the majority of the people in the committees were frightened that the real scandals, the drug scandals, for example, would really threaten any future conduct of covert operations on the scale that they had been handled in the past. And so they were trying very deliberately to limit the damage. This was damage control.
And so they were pulling their punches on all the major questions and issues of what really happened in this thing, what the CIA's role was. Anytime they got into anything that was really sensitive about exactly that, exactly what the CIA's role was and exactly what laws were broken and when, they went into secret session.
There was a lot of talk during the hearings about covert operations, national security, the necessity of secrecy in conducting foreign policy. But some experts claim that covert action does not work in the interest of the U.S. national security, nor does it create a more stable world.
To think of the democratic governments that have been overthrown in the last 30 years by military coups is almost like giving a capsule history of CIA covert operations in the last 30 years. I mean, there was the overthrow of Prime Minister Mossadegh in Iran in 1953. There was the overthrow of Arbenz in Guatemala in 1954. There was the overthrow of the Brazilian government in 1964. There was the overthrow of the Ghana government in 1966. A lot of the governments I've just mentioned got into trouble with the international oil companies because they tried to assert their national prerogatives over their own resources. Time after time, the CIA has come in on behalf of those multinational companies.
Start a huge covert war that you intend is going to be secret. It's not secret from the Russians. Certainly not secret from the Laotians who are getting shot at, or the Angolans or the Nicaraguans or whoever it is. It's covert from the American taxpayer and voter. And a lot of people make a lot of money off of it. And it attracts criminals. And it has every single time.
Who are the names, the faces, behind these covert activities? Some, like Oliver North, General Secord, Albert Hakim, are practically household names. But Daniel Sheehan, chief legal counsel for the Christic Institute, a public interest law firm, believes there are other influential players involved.
There exists, in operation now, a secret team of some two dozen men, former Central Intelligence Agency covert operatives,